Tonight, on a special 2-hour 2020. The man who remade the worlds of music and dance. Michael Jackson's universal fame as he blazed into musical history. Tonight, the artists who followed his lead to become the breakout stars of their generations. The barriers he broke with every note he sang. Every step he danced. And the culture he changed forever. Michael Jackson, the man and his music. Here's Elizabeth Vargas.
Good evening. In shock, the world continues to mourn and say goodbye to the king of pop, Michael Jackson. Tonight, our celebration of the music and the man, quite possibly the greatest entertainer of all time. He would have been 51 years old in just 2 months, and he was on stage during every one of those 5 decades. Fans from the 80s called him our generation's Elvis. Beyoncé said he made a bigger impact on music than any other artist in history. So how did the music begin? How did the child of a steel worker in Gary, Indiana, go on to change musical history forever?
It's 1968. Michael Jackson and his 4 older brothers, powered by their father's ambition, are playing in Gary, Indiana. But they are dreaming of Detroit, home of Motown Records, founded by Berry Gordy, the hitmaker behind the great soul acts of the Stees. Berry's assistant, Suzanne DePass, sees the Jacksons perform.
My gosh, that's pretty special. Because this little tiny boy was singing with all the soul and passion of a 35-year-old man. I called Berry Gordy and I said, Mr. Gordy, I have seen something that is just great. He said, really? What is it? I said, it's an act. It's a fabulous singing group. He said, great. I said, they range in age from like 8 to 15. He said, kids?
So when she mentioned about another kids group, I just said, hey, I'm not really interested in another kids group. Not at this time.
I persisted and he said, well, gosh, if you feel that strongly about it, I'll take a look. And he did.
They came to Motown. This is a film of the audition.
When I first saw them, there was no question that I was interested, not only interested, but I loved them all. You know, I mean, it's incredible. I mean, it didn't take a genius to realize that they had, you know, the talent. And Michael was extremely special.
Gordy assigned Suzanne DePass to groom the boys, pick their clothing, choreograph dance steps, and make them rehearse and rehearse, while Gordy started looking for the song, the big hit.
And I thought about Michael and this little kid, and I wanted a song that would fit a 9-year-old kid, you know, and so I walked around singing a melody that just came into my head while thinking about this phenomenal kid. Oh, baby. No, I would say, oh, baby, da-da-dee-da-dee, da-da-da-da. That's all I had.
Oh, baby, give me one more chance.
Tell you that I love you.
Won't you please let me rock your heart?
Was the first release, and that went straight to number one. It was just a major smash.
I was probably in fourth grade, and I just remember walking home from school and just hearing that song coming out of car radios and little transistor. We had little transistor radios. I mean, it wasn't like Walkmans or boom boxes or anything, little tiny transistor radios, AM radio. And I just remember that song just It was the bomb. It was the bomb song.
In one quick succession, three more number one hits exploded on the airwaves.
It absolutely went from complete anonymity to total celebrity in one beat. The first time we got off the plane in Philadelphia for their first concert, they got mobbed, and it never changed. That was pretty profound for those days because there had not yet been, I don't think, a young black group that had created what was tantamount to Beatlemania.
A black group shattering mainstream barriers and a little boy, the obsessive force driving it all. Don't you know
sit around? His brothers might be outside, you know, playing basketball, but he'd be watching the producers mix the record or asking Berry Gordy 1,001 questions about producing and about the business and about why this, why that.
And then I realized that he was studying me. Later I realized, of course, he's not only studied me, but he studied everybody. From Walt Disney, Marcel Marceau, James Brown, Jackie Wilson, you know, all these people he was really studying.
We used to call him the human sponge.
It was inevitable. After 4 years of hits together, traveling together, performing together, Michael Jackson would shoot ahead of his brothers like a meteor.
When we first started, it was all for one, one for all. And I think as the press and the fans recognized Michael more and more, and it became a disproportionate kind of worship for him, you know, and interest in him, and obsession with the little one, that it drove a wedge between and among his brothers and himself and his brothers' relationships to one another.
So what would that wedge do to the five brothers? When we come back, how one of the five became the one and only and reinvented pop music. We're looking at a live shot of the boyhood home of Michael Jackson in Gary, Indiana, about 2 hours outside Chicago. It has been turned into a shrine tonight by fans who want to pay their respects. And Michael Jackson once said, "The thing I like most about being on stage is making people happy because I'm here for a reason. That's my job. I've been doing it for so long," he said. "As long as people enjoy it, I'll also be happy." Happy is what he made millions of us as his music continued to evolve and push the very limits of what a voice could do and entertainment could mean. By the early 1980s, the Jackson 5 began to fade. Michael's solo career took off. Stop Till You Get Enough was the first single from the album Off the Wall, produced by legendary composer and arranger Quincy Jones.